Good morning everyone, welcome back to my channel, and today we will be reviewing about civil laws. Okay, to begin with, Civil Law Review Pre-Week Notes Part 1. At kung bago ka lang sa channel ko, don't forget to like and subscribe at i-on ang notification para pag may bagong bar review videos ako, updated ka. Laban lang mga ka-bar examinees.
The very first topic that we will be discussing or we will be reviewing is about the preliminary matters. In preliminary matters, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 topics here. The first one is effect and application of laws. The second one is the ignorance of the law. The third is the legal periods. The fourth is the conflict of laws. And last but not the least is the human relations. Okay, let's start. The first topic is effect and application of laws. Effect and application of laws. Effectivity of a law will depend on whether or not it has provided a specific date for its effectivity. I repeat, effectivity of a law will depend on whether or not it has provided a specific date for its effectivity. So there are four topics here. The first one is if date is specified. The second is if no date is specified. Third, if the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval. The fourth is if the law is voluminous. So I repeat. The first one is if date is specified. The second one is if no date is specified. The third is if the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval. And the fourth one is if the law is voluminous. Okay. The first one is if date is specified. So, if date is specified, this is upon the lapse. I repeat, if date is specified, this is upon the lapse of the said period following its complete publication. So, I repeat, if date is specified, this is upon the lapse of the said period following its complete publication. The second one is, if no date is specified. If no date is specified, this means 15-day period, which may either be on the 15th or on the 16th day, depending on the language used by the Congress in fixing the effectivity date of the statute. I repeat, if no date is specified, it means 15-day period, which may either be on the 15th or the 16th day, depending on the language used by the Congress on fixing the effectivity date of the statute. Number 3. If the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval. Number 3. If the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval, this means that it is effective immediately after its complete publication and not after signing by the president. I repeat, if the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval, it is effective immediately after its complete publication and not after signing by the president. Number 4, if the law is voluminous, it means reckoning shall begin from the release of the last of the series. I repeat, if the law is voluminous, reckoning shall begin from the release of the last of the series. So I repeat the four issues. The first one is, if date is specified, this is upon the lapse of the said period following its complete publication. Number 2, if no date is specified, this means 15-day period, which may either be on the 15th or the 16th day, depending on the language used by the Congress in fixing the effectivity date of the statute. Number 3, if the law provides for immediate effectivity or upon approval, it is effective immediately after its complete publication and not after signing by the president. Number fourth, if the law is voluminous, the reckoning period shall begin from the release of the last of the series. The publication is indispensable in every case, but the legislature may, in its discretion, provide that the usual 15-day period shall be shortened or extended. I repeat, the publication is indispensable in every case, but the legislature may, in its discretion, provide that the usual 15-day period shall be shortened or extended. Administrative rules and regulations must also be published if their purpose is to enforce or implement existing laws pursuant also to a valid delegation. Interpretative regulations and those merely internal in nature, that is, regulating only the personnel of the administrative agency and not the public, which is need not be published. I repeat, the administrative rules and regulations must also be published if their purpose is to enforce or implement existing laws pursuant also to a valid delegation. Interpretative regulations and those merely internal in nature, that is, regulating only the personnel of the administrative agency and not the public, need not be published. So that is the effect and application of laws. The second topic that we're going to be reading is the ignorance of the law. I repeat, about the ignorance of the law. The general rule here is that everyone is conclusively presumed to know the law. I repeat, the general rule is that everyone is conclusively presumed to know the law. Hence, ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith. I repeat, the general rule is that everyone is conclusively presumed to know the law. Hence, ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith. The conclusive presumption that every person knows the law presupposes that the law has been published. Without such notice and publication, there would be no basis for the application of the maxim ignorantia leges non excusat. I repeat, the conclusive presumption that every person knows the law presupposes that the law has been published. Without such notice and publication, there would be no basis for the application of the maxim ignorantia leges non excusat. But there are also exemptions. The exemptions are three exemptions. The first one is mistake upon a doubtful or difficult question of law may be the basis of a good faith. I repeat, mistake upon a doubtful or difficult question of law may be the basis of good faith. This is based on Article 526. The second one is payment by reason of a mistake in the construction or application of a doubtful or difficult question of law may come within the scope of the preceding article. I repeat, the second exemption is that payment by reason of a mistake in a construction or application of a doubtful or difficult question of law may come within the scope of preceding article. This is based on Article 2155 of the Civil Code. And the third one is, in order that fraud may make a contract voidable, it should be serious and should not have been employed by both contracting parties. It means incidental fraud only obliges the person employing it to pay damages. I repeat, in order that fraud may make a contract voidable, it should be serious and should not have been employed by both contracting parties. So, incidental fraud only obliges the person employing it to pay damages. This is based on Article 1344. Okay, I repeat, the ignorance of the topic of ignorance of the law. The general rule is that everyone is conclusively presumed to know the law. Hence, ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith. The conclusive presumption that every person knows the law presupposes that the law has been published. Without such notice and publication, there would be no basis for the application of the maxim ignorantia leges non excusat. And there are three exemptions. Number one, mistake upon a doubtful or difficult question of law may be the basis of good faith. This is based on Article 526. The second one is payment by reason of mistake in the construction or application of a doubtful or difficult question of law may come within the scope of the preceding article. This is based on Article 2155. And the third one is, in order that fraud may make a contract voidable, it should be serious and should not have been employed by both contracting parties. This is incidental fraud, which only obliges the person employing it to pay damages. Okay, the next topic is, the next topic of the preliminary matters is about the legal periods. I repeat, this is about the legal periods. So this is refers to the computation of period, the computation of period. So the first one here is year. When we talk about year, it means 12 calendar months. I repeat, it is 12 calendar months. The second one is month. If it is month, it refers 30 days. Unless designated by their name, in which case they shall be computed according to the number of days which they respectively have. I repeat, month, 30 days, unless designated by their name, in which case they shall be computed according to the number of days which they respectively have. The third one is the day. In terms of the day, this refers to the 24 hours. Next is nighttime. The nighttime refers to from sunset to sunrise. Nighttime refers to the from sunset to sunrise. And when it talks about the week, it means 7 successive days, regardless of which day it would start. I repeat, when it comes to week, it refers to the 7 successive days, regardless of which day it would start. And last but not the least is the calendar week. When it comes to calendar week, it means Sunday to Saturday. Sunday to Saturday. So I repeat, the computation of period, the first one is year. This refers to the 12 calendar months. Note, the provisions of Section 31, Chapter 7, Book 1 of the Administrative Code of 1987, being a more recent law, governs the computation of legal period with respect to counting a year. The court explained that calendar month is a month designated in the calendar without regard to the number of days it may contain. Next, the second one is month, so this refers to the 30 days unless designated by their name, in which case they shall be computed according to the number of days which they respectively had. Next is the day. This refers to the 24 hours. The fourth one is nighttime, so this is from sunset to sunrise. Next is about the week. When we talk about week, it means 7 successive days, regardless of which day it would start. And last is the calendar week, which is refers to Sunday to Saturday. Okay, the next topic of the preliminary matters is the conflict of laws. The conflict of laws. The first one here is the application of the laws, the application of the laws. Okay. In application of the laws, in terms of conflict of laws, in application of laws, the first one here is the penal laws. The general rule is territoriality rule. I repeat, in application of laws with regards to the penal laws, the general rule is territoriality rule. The penal laws and laws of public security and safety shall be obligatory upon all who live or sojourn in the Philippine territory. This can be found in Article 14. I repeat, in application of laws, the first one here is the penal law, and the general rule is the territoriality rule. So, the penal laws and laws of a public security and safety shall be obligatory upon all who live or sojourn in the Philippine territory. This can be found in Article 14 of the Civil Code. But there are exemptions. The exemptions is the Philippine penal laws will not apply. The Philippine penal laws will not apply by virtue of, the first one is the treaty stipulations. I repeat, with regards to the general rule of territoriality, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 exemptions. So the exemptions are the Philippine penal laws will not apply by virtue of, the first one is treaty stipulations. The second one is principles of public international law. The second one is principle of public international law. The third one is laws of preferential applications. This refers to the ambassadors and ministers. I repeat, the third one is laws of preferential applications. This refers to the ambassadors and ministers. And the fourth one is international agencies enjoying diplomatic immunity. Okay, I repeat, in application of laws, the first one is penal law. The general rule here about the penal laws is that there is a territoriality rule, which the penal laws and laws of public security and safety shall be obligatory upon all who live or sojourn in the Philippine territory. But there are 1, 2, 3, 4 exemptions. The exemptions is that the Philippine penal laws will not apply by virtue of, the first one, treaty applications, treaty stipulations. The second one is principles of public international law, and the third one is laws of preferential applications. The fourth one is international agencies enjoying the diplomatic immunity. The second application of laws is the status laws. I repeat, the second application of laws is the status laws. The general rule here is that nationality rule, which is lex nationali. I repeat, the general rule is nationality rule, which is lex nationali. This is laws relating to, number one, family rights and duties, number two, status and condition, number three, legal capacity of persons are binding upon citizens of the Philippines even though living abroad. Okay, I repeat, with regards to the status law, the general rule is that nationality rule, which is the lex nationali. Laws relating to, number one, family rights and duties, number two, status and conditions, number three, legal capacity of persons are binding upon citizens of the Philippines even though living abroad. This refers to the Article 15. Take note that this was asked in the bar last 1919, 2003, 2004, 2005, 2009. Okay, I repeat, this is about the status law. The general rule here is the nationality law, which is lex nationali. This is laws relating to, number one, family rights and duties, number two, status and conditions, number three, legal capacity of person are binding upon the citizens of the Philippines even though living abroad. But there are one, two exemptions. So the two exemptions here is in case of divorce obtained validly by an alien pursuant to the rules that governs his country, the Filipino spouse shall be considered also as divorced. The divorce decree must capacitate a foreigner to remarry, otherwise the Filipino cannot remarry. I repeat, with regards to the exemptions, the exemption number one is in case of divorce obtained validly by an alien pursuant to the rule that governs his country, the Filipino spouse shall be considered also a divorced. This is based on the case of Van Dorn versus Romelio Jr., GR number L68470, October 8, 1985. The divorce decree must capacitate foreigner to remarry, otherwise the Filipino cannot marry. So once it is proven, however, that a party was no longer a Filipino citizen when he obtained the divorce from his Filipino spouse, the ruling in Van Dorn would also apply. Thus, the validity of the divorce will be determined based on the law of the country of which he is a citizen at the time the valid divorce is obtained. Okay, that is the first exemption. So, the first exemption, I repeat, in case of divorce obtained validly by an alien pursuant to the rules that govern his country, the Filipino spouse shall be considered also a divorce. The divorce decree must capacitate foreigner to remarry, otherwise the Filipino cannot remarry. So once it is proven, however, that a party was no longer a Filipino citizen when he obtained the divorce from his Filipino spouse, the ruling in Van Dorn would also apply. Thus, the validity of the divorce will be determined based on the law of the country of which he is a citizen at the time the valid divorce is obtained. Okay, the second exemption here is the domiciliary rule applies to the stateless persons. I repeat, the second exemptions of the status rule or the status law is the domiciliary rule applies to the stateless person. Okay, the next topic here that we're going to read is about the real statutes or the laws on property. I repeat, the real statutes, which is about the rules on property. The general rule is lex rei sitai. Sitai. I really don't know how to read this one. The general rule is lex rei sitai. Real property as well as personal property is subject to the law of the country where it is situated. I repeat, lex rei sitai. Real property as well as personal property is subject to the law of the country where it is situated. So, nakadepende yun kung saan siya where is the property situated. So, this is based on Article 16. And take note, this was asked many times in the bar. So, there are exemptions of the rule. With regards to the real estates, or with regards to the general rule of where the property is situated. The first exemptions here is succession. As to order of succession, amount of successional rights, and intrinsic validity of the testamentary provisions governed by national law. Or it is not lex situs. I repeat, successions as to order of succession, amount of successional rights, and intrinsic validity of the testamentary provisions governed, which is governed by the national law in the Philippines, and it is not lex situs. Okay, the second one here is the contracts involving real property but do not deal with title or real rights over the property. The issue being the contractual rights and liabilities of parties governed by the proper law of the contract. So this refers to lex lucy voluntatis or lex lucy intentionis. I repeat, contracts involving real property but do not deal with title or real rights over the property. The issues being the contractual rights and liabilities of parties governed by the proper law of contract. So this refers to lex loci voluntatis or lex loci intentionis. The third one here, or the third exemption, is in contracts where real property is given as security by way of mortgage to secure a principal contract. Or it refers to a loan which is governed by the proper law of the contract while the mortgage is governed by the lex situs. So I repeat, in contracts where real property is given as a security by way of mortgage to secure a principal contract, or example, a loan. So a loan is governed by the proper law of the contract while the mortgage is governed by the lex situs. Okay, the fourth one here is while the validity of the transfer of land must be determined by the lex situs, the validity of the contracts to transfer is determined by the proper law of the contract. So I repeat, while the validity of the transfer of land must be determined by the lex situs, the validity of the contract to transfer is determined by the proper law of the contracts. So those are the 1, 2, 3, 4 exemptions. So I repeat, this refers to the conflict of laws. The first one that I read is about the application of laws. The first one is the penal laws. The second one is the status laws. And the third one that I just read is about the real statutes, which is the laws on the property. So I repeat, the general rule here is lex re sitae, which is the real property as well as personal property in subject to the law of the country where it is situated. The exemptions of these is the first one here is the succession as to order of succession, which is amount of the successional rights and intrinsic validity of the testamentary provisions, which is governed by the national law in the Philippines and it is not lex situs. The second one here is the contracts involving real property but do not deal with title or real rights over the property. The issue being the contractual rights and liabilities of parties governed by the proper law of the contract. The third one here is the contracts where the real property is given as security by way of mortgage to secure a principal contract. So this refers to the loan, which is a loan is governed by the property law of the contract while the mortgage is governed by the lex situs. And the fourth one here is while the validity of the transfer of land must be determined by the lex situs, the validity of the contract to transfer is determined by the proper law of the contract. Okay, the fourth topic here is about law governing extrinsic validity of contracts, which is wills and public instruments. So I repeat, the fourth one or the fourth topic of the conflict of laws. The first that we're going, the fourth one is the law governing extrinsic validity of contracts, wills, and public instruments. So the general rule here is lex lucy celebrationes. I repeat, the general rule is lex lucy celebrationes, which is found in Article 17 of the Civil Code. So forms and solemnities of contracts, wills, and other public instruments shall be governed by the laws of the of the country in which they are executed. So I repeat, the general rule is lex luci celebrationes, which is found in Article 17. The forms and solemnities of the contracts, wills, and other public instruments shall be governed by the laws of the country in which they are executed. But we have an exemptions here. The exemptions is the Philippine law shall apply in the following cases even though performed abroad. So I repeat, the exemptions is the Philippine law shall apply in the following cases even though performed abroad. Number one, acts are executed before the diplomatic or consular officials of the Philippines. So that is the first exemption. I repeat, the first exemption is that acts are executed before the diplomatic or consular officials of the Philippines. The second exemption is the prohibitory laws governing persons. There are acts or property and those which have for their object public order, public policy, and good customs. I repeat, the second exemption is prohibitory laws governing persons, their acts or property, and those which have for their object public order, public policy, and good customs. The third one, okay, there's no third one. So that's just two exemptions of the laws governing extrinsic validity of the contracts, wills, and public instruments. So I repeat, the general rule is lex luce celebrationes, which is found in Article 17 of the Civil Code, which refers to the forms and solemnities of the contracts, wills, and other public instruments, shall be governed by the laws of the country in which they are executed. So the exemptions here is the Philippine law shall apply in the following cases even though performed abroad. The first one here is acts are executed before the diplomatic or consular officials of the Philippines. The second exemption is the prohibitory laws concerning persons, their acts or property, and those which have for their object public order, public policy, and good customs. That can be found in Article 17. All right. Next, we will be having the conflict of laws doctrines. Okay. The conflict of laws doctrines. Please bear with me while I read this Latin words. Okay, the first one here is the Renvoi doctrine, or it means referring back. So the first conflict of laws doctrine here is the Renvoi doctrine, which means referring back. The second is transmission theory. The second is transmission theory. The third one is doctrine of processual presumption. The third one is doctrine of processual presumption. The fourth one is the doctrine of operative fact. The fourth one is doctrine of operative fact. And the fifth one is dipicage. Dipicage or dipicage. Sorry, I did not research of how to pronounce these words, but it could be that I forgot how to pronounce, maybe, because it's been years since I took my very first bar exam, and I am hoping that this time we will be passing the bar exam for the third time. So, okay, I repeat, the conflict of laws doctrines. So, the conflict of laws doctrines are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, the first one here is Renvoi doctrine, which means referring back. The second is transmission theory. The third doctrine is the processual presumption. The fourth is doctrine of operative fact. And the fifth one is dipicage or dipicage. Okay, so the first one here is Renvoi doctrine or referring back. So the Renvoi takes place when the conflict
The conflicts rules of a forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that returns or refers to matter back to the law of the forum, or it means remission. I repeat, the renvoi doctrine, or it means referring back. This renvoi doctrines, this renvoi takes place when the conflicts rule of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law. So I repeat, the renvoi takes place when the conflicts rule of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that returns or refers the matter, which is going back to the law of the forum, or it is called remission. So that is the first conflict of laws doctrines. The second one is transmission theory. Transmission theory provides that when the conflicts rule of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that refers it to a third country, which is the law of the third country shall apply. I repeat, transmission theory. This is the second conflict law doctrine. The transmission theory provides that when the conflict rule of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that refers it to the third country, and the law of the third country shall apply. That is the transmission theory. Okay, I repeat for the third time. Transmission theory. So, transmission theory provides that when the conflict rule of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that refers it to a third country, which is the law of the third country shall be applied. Okay, the third doctrine that we're going to read is about the doctrine of processual presumption. I repeat, the doctrine of processual presumption. The foreign law, wherever applicable, shall be proved by the prominent thereof. Otherwise, such law shall be presumed to be exactly the same as the law of the forum. I repeat, the doctrine of processual presumption, the foreign law, whenever applicable, should be proved by the prominent thereof. Otherwise, such law shall be presumed to be exactly the same as the law of the forum. The doctrine of presumed identity approach in private international law is also known as the doctrine of processual presumption. Okay, I repeat, the doctrine of processual presumption, which is the third conflict of law doctrines, the doctrine of processual presumption, the foreign law, whenever applicable, shall be proved by the prominent thereof. Otherwise, such law shall be presumed to be exactly the same as the law of the forum. And the doctrine of presumed identity approach in private international law is also known as the doctrine of processual presumption. This is based on Orion Savings Bank versus Suzuki, JR number 205487, November 12, 2014. I repeat, Orion Savings Bank versus Suzuki, JR number 205487, November 12, 2014. Okay, the fourth doctrine that we're going to read is that is about the conflict of laws doctrine. The fourth doctrine is operative fact. Operative fact. In operative fact, acts done pursuant to a law which was subsequently declared unconstitutional remained valid, but not when the acts are done after the declaration of unconstitutionality. I repeat, the doctrine of operative fact, which is acts done pursuant to a law which was subsequently declared unconstitutional, remained valid, but not when the acts are done after the declaration of unconstitutionality. I repeat, the doctrine of operative fact, which is one of the conflict of laws doctrine, these are the acts done pursuant to a law which was subsequently declared unconstitutional, which is remained valid, but not when the acts are done after the declaration of unconstitutionality. Okay? I repeat, the doctrine of operative fact. This is the acts done pursuant to a law which was subsequently declared unconstitutional remain valid. So, bago pa lang siya naging unconstitutional. So, it remained valid, but not when the acts are done after the declaration of unconstitutionality. Okay, the fifth conflict of laws doctrine is the dipicage. I don't know how to pronounce this one because when I research it, it has different pronunciation. So, dipicage or dipicage, dipicage, D-E-P-E-C-A-G-E, D-E-P-E-C-A-G-E, dipicage, dipicage, dipicage. Okay, dipicage is a conflict of laws where different issues within a case may be governed by the laws of different states. I repeat, dipicage or dipicage is a conflict of laws where different issues within a case may be governed by the laws of different states. In common law countries, dipicage usually means a single contract which provides that different parts of a contract shall be governed by different laws. I repeat, dipicage is a contract of laws where different issues within a case may be governed by a laws of a different states. In common law countries, dipicage usually means a single contract which provides that different parts of a contract shall be governed by different laws. Okay, those are the five conflict of laws doctrine. Okay, I repeat, I will be reading again the five conflict laws doctrine. So the first one here is the Renvoi doctrine, which means referring back. The Renvoi doctrine takes place when the conflict's rule of a forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that refers the matter back to the law of the forum, or it means remission. The second one is the transmission theory, which provides that when the conflict's rules of the forum makes a reference to a foreign law, but the foreign law is found to contain a conflict rule that refers it to a third country, the law of the third country shall apply. The third doctrine is the doctrine of processual presumption. The doctrine of processual presumption is the foreign law, whenever applicable, should be proved by the prominence thereof. Otherwise, such law shall be presumed to be exactly the same as the law of the forum. The doctrine of presumed identity approach in private international law is also known as the doctrine of processual presumption. The fourth doctrine or the fourth conflict law doctrine is the doctrine of operative fact. The doctrine of operative fact is an act done pursuant to a law which was subsequently declared unconstitutional remained valid, but not when the acts are done after the declaration of unconstitutionality. And the fifth one is the dipicage. Is a conflict of laws where different issues within a case may be governed by the laws of different statutes or different states. In common law countries, dipicage usually means a single contract which provides that different parts of the contract shall be governed by different laws. So there you have it. Those are the five doctrines or the five conflict of laws doctrine. I repeat, the first one is renvoi doctrine, which means referring back. The second is the transmission theory. The third one is the doctrine of processual presumption. The fourth is doctrine of operative fact. And the fifth is dipicage. Okay, next here is we have the effects of laws, judgments promulgated or conventions agreed upon in a foreign country on Philippine prohibitive laws. I repeat, effects of laws, judgment promulgated or conventions agreed upon in a foreign country on Philippine prohibitive laws. The general rule here is the prohibitive laws concerning persons, their acts or property, and laws which have for their object public order, public policy, or good customs are not rendered effectively by laws, judgment promulgated, or conventions agreed upon in foreign country. I repeat, effects of laws, judgments promulgated, or conventions agreed upon in a foreign country on Philippine prohibitive laws. The general rule here is that prohibitive laws concerning persons, their acts or properties, and laws which have for their object public order, the public policy, or good customs are not rendered ineffective by laws, judgments promulgated or conventions agreed upon in foreign country. Okay, the exemptions here of the general rule is that mixed marriages. Okay, the exemptions are mixed marriages where the foreigner obtained a divorce decree abroad and was thereby capacitated to remarry. This is based on Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code. In this case, even though divorce is not recognized in the Philippines as a mode of terminating marriages, still the marriage is terminated by virtue of a judgment of divorce and issuance of a divorce decree by a foreign court. Okay, I repeat, the effects of laws, judgments promulgated, or conventions agreed upon in a foreign country on Philippine prohibitive laws. The general rule is that the prohibitive laws concerning persons, their acts, or property, and law, which have for their object public order or public policy or good customs, are not rendered ineffective by laws, judgment promulgated, or conventions agreed upon in foreign country. But the exemptions here is that the mixed marriages where the foreigner obtained a divorce decree abroad and was thereby capacitated to remarry, which is based on Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code. In this case, even though divorce is not recognized in the Philippines as a mode of terminating marriages, still, the marriage is terminated by virtue of a judgment of divorce and issuance of a divorce decree by a foreign court. Okay, we have here the requirements for the application of Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code. I repeat, the requirements for the applications of the Paragraph 26, Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code. The first one here is, there is a valid marriage. I repeat, there is a valid marriage that has been celebrated between a Filipino citizen and a foreigner. I repeat, the first requirement for the application of Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code is number 1, there is a valid marriage that has been celebrated between a Filipino citizen and a foreigner. The second requirement is a valid divorce is obtained abroad. I repeat, a valid divorce is obtained abroad by the alien spouse capacitating him or her to remarry. This is based on Albano 2013 book. I repeat, the requirements for the application of Article 26, Paragraph 2 of the Family Code. The first one here is there is a valid marriage that has been celebrated between a Filipino citizen and a foreigner. Number 2, a valid divorce is obtained abroad by the alien spouse capacitating him or her to remarry. Okay, those are the two requirements. Okay, let's proceed to another topic. This is the law that governs the validity of marriage in case of mixed marriages. I repeat, law that governs the validity of marriage in case of mixed marriages. So the first one here is the marriage between a Filipino and a foreigner abroad. I repeat, this is the law that governs the validity of marriage in case of mixed marriages. The first one here is the marriage between a Filipino and a foreigner abroad. Okay, if the marriage is valid under the law of one of the spouses, while void under the law of the other, the validity of the marriage should be upheld. Unless the marriage is universally incestuous or highly immoral, or it means the same rule as the foreigner who get married abroad. Okay, I repeat the topic. It is about the law that governs the validity of marriage in case of mixed marriages. The first one here is the marriage between the Filipino and a foreigner abroad. If the marriage is valid under the law of one of the spouses while void under the law of the other, the validity of the marriage should be upheld. Unless the marriage is universally incestuous or highly immoral. Okay. The second law that governs the validity of marriage is the marriage between Filipino and a foreigner in the Philippines. I repeat, the marriage between the Filipino and a foreigner in the Philippines. The first one was the marriage between a Filipino and foreigner abroad. The second one here that I just read is the marriage between the Filipino and a foreigner in the Philippines. Okay. The national law of the Filipino or the Philippine law should be followed. Otherwise, the country's public policy would be violated. I repeat, in marriage and marriages between a Filipino and a foreigner in the Philippines is that the national law of the Filipino or the Philippine law should be followed. Otherwise, the country's public policy would be violated. Okay, let's proceed to another topic here. Still on the conflict of laws, the law that governs the personal relations of the spouse. Okay, the law that governs the personal relations of the spouse. The general rule here is the personal relations of the spouses are governed by the national law of the husband. I repeat, the personal relations of the spouses are governed by the national law of the husband. That is the general rule. Okay, alien women who marries a Filipino husband. I repeat, alien woman who marries a Filipino husband. So this is ipso facto becomes a Filipino citizen if she does not suffer any disqualification for naturalization as a Filipino citizen. So personal relations, this is national law of the husband shall govern. Going back, that is the general rule. I repeat from the top. This is the laws that governs the personal relations of the spouses. The general rule is the personal relations of the spouses are governed by the national law of the husband. So example here is an alien woman who marries a Filipino husband. I repeat, an alien woman who marries a Filipino husband. So this is ipso facto becomes a Filipino citizen. Ipso facto becomes a Filipino citizen if she does not suffer any disqualification for naturalization as a Filipino citizen. So the personal relations here is that the national law of the husband shall govern as to the general rule. Okay, the second one here is a Filipina who marries an alien husband. I repeat, a Filipina who marries an alien husband. So the Constitution provides that she shall retain her Philippine citizenship. Okay? I repeat, a Filipino, or rather a Filipina, which is a girl, a Filipina who marries an alien husband, the Constitution provides that she shall retain her Philippine citizenship. Constitution provides that she shall retain her Philippine citizenship unless, by her act or omission, she is deemed under our law to have renounced her citizenship. I repeat, Constitution provides that she shall retain her Philippine citizenship unless, by her act or omission, she is deemed under our law to have renounced her citizenship. So, in personal relations, the national law of the wife or Philippine law would govern the spouse's personal relations. So, the rule was intended to protect the Filipino wife. This can be found in Article 80 of the Philippine Code. So I repeat, the laws that govern the personal relations of the spouses. The general rule is the personal relations of the spouses are governed by the national law of the husband. So an alien woman who marries a Filipino husband, so ipso facto becomes a Filipino citizen if she does not suffer any disqualification for naturalization as a Filipino citizen. And the personal relations is that national law of the husband shall govern. Next here, the next scenario is a Filipina who marries an alien husband. The Constitution provides that she shall retain her Philippine citizenship unless by her act or omission she is deemed under our law to have renounced her citizenship. So the personal relations, national law of the wife or Philippine law would govern the spouse's personal relations, which is the rule was intended to protect the Filipino wife. This is based on Article 80 of the Family Code. Okay. The next topic that we will be reading is about the effects of change of nationalities of the spouses governing the law. I repeat, the effects of change of nationalities of the spouses governing the law. The first one here, I repeat, the effects of change of nationalities of the spouses governing the national law. This refers to the Article 15 of the Civil Code. Okay, the first one here is, if the spouses have the same nationality, but they acquire a new nationality by their common act, their new national law will govern their personal relations. I repeat, this is about the effects of change of nationalities of the spouses governing law. The first one here is, if the spouses have the same nationality but they acquire a new nationality by their common act, it means that their new national law will govern their personal relations. Okay. The second effects of change of nationalities of the spouses is about if the husband alone changes his nationality after the marriage. I repeat, if the husband alone changes his nationality after the marriage, the law of the last common nationality of the spouses shall govern. I repeat, if the husband alone changes his nationality after the marriage, the law of the last common nationality of the spouse would govern. Number 3, if the spouses retain their different nationalities after the marriage, the national law of both spouses should govern. I repeat, if the spouses retain their different nationalities after the marriage, the national law of both spouses should govern. Okay, I repeat, effects of the change of nationalities of the spouses governing law. Number 1, if the spouses have the same nationality but they acquire a new nationality by their common act, their new national law will govern their personal relations. I repeat, if the spouses have the same nationality but they acquire a new nationality by their common act, their new national law will govern their personal relations. The second here is, if the husband alone changes his nationality after the marriage, the law of the last common nationality of the spouses would govern. And I repeat, if the husband alone changes his nationality after the marriage, the law of the last common nationality of the spouses would govern. And number 3 is, if the spouses retain their different nationalities after the marriage, I repeat, if the spouses retain their different nationalities after the marriage, it means that national law of both spouses should govern. Okay, so that is the effect of change of nationalities of the spouses governing the law. And our last topic here for today is about the human relations. Human relations. Okay, the first one here is abuse of right. Abuse of right. Abuse of right. This was asked in 2006 bar exam. Abuse of right. When a right is exercised in a manner which does not conform to the norms enshrined in Article 19 and results in damage to another, a legal wrong is thereby committed for which the wrongdoer must be held responsible. I repeat, abuse of right. Again, this is the topic of human relations. The first one here is abuse of right. Abuse of right. When a right is exercised in a manner which does not conform to the norms enshrined in Article 19 and results in damage to another, a legal wrong is thereby committed for which the wrongdoer must be held responsible. The elements here is, the first one is there is a legal right or a duty. The second here is such duty is exercised in bad faith. The third is it is for the sole intent of prejudicing or injuring another. And the fourth is the absence of good faith is essential to abuse of right. Okay. I repeat, abuse of right. When a right is exercised in a manner which does not conform to the norms enshrined in Article 19 and results in damage to another, a legal wrong is thereby committed for which the wrongdoer must be held responsible. The elements here are, number 1, There is a legal right or duty. Number one, there is a legal right or duty. Number two, such duty is exercised in bad faith. Number two, such duty is exercised in bad faith. Number three, it is for the sole intent of prejudicing or injuring another. Number three, it is for the sole intent of prejudicing or injuring another. Number four, the absence of good faith is essential to abuse of right. Number four, the absence of good faith is essential to abuse of right. Okay, so that is the abuse of right. Okay, next is the principle of damnum absque injuria. I repeat, the principle of damnum absque injuria. One who merely exercises one rights does no actionable injury and cannot be held liable for damages. This is premised on the valid exercise of a right. I repeat, the principle of damnum absque injuria. One who merely exercises one's rights does no actionable injury and cannot be held liable for damages. This is premised on the valid exercise of a right. This is based on the case of Amonoy versus Gutierrez, GR number 140420, February 15, 2001. So, injury is the illegal invasion of a legal right. The damage is loss, hurt, or harm, which results from injury, and damages are the recompense or compensation awarded to the damage suffered. There can be damage without injury in those instances in which the loss or harm was not the result of a violation of a legal duty. In such cases, the consequences must be borne by the injured person alone. I repeat, in the principle of damnum absque injura, one who merely exercises one's right does no actionable injury and cannot be held liable for damages. This is premised on the valid exercise of a right. Injury is the illegal invasion of a legal right. I repeat, what is injury is the illegal invasion of a legal right. This refers to the damage is the loss. The damage is the loss, the harm, the hurt, which results from the injury, and the damages are the recompense or compensation awarded to the damage suffered. There can be damage without injury in those instances in which the loss or harm was not the result of a violation of a legal duty. In such cases, the consequences must be borne by the injured persons alone. Okay. Next here is, the mere fact that the respondent suffered losses does not give rise to a right to recover damages. I repeat, the mere fact that the respondent suffered losses does not give rise to a right to recover damages. To warrant the recovery of damages, there must be both a right of action for a legal wrong inflicted by the plaintiff and damage resulting to the respondent therefrom. I repeat, the mere fact that the respondents suffered losses does not give rise to a right to recovery damages. To warrant the recovery of damages, there must be both a right of action for a legal wrong inflicted by the plaintiff and a damage resulting to the respondent therefrom. This is based on the case of the Orchard Golf and Country Club Incorporated versus Ernesto Yu GR number 191033 January 11, 2016. Okay, next here is the Article 19, 20, and 21 in the Enforcement and Sanctions of Abuse of Right. I repeat, Article 19, 20, and 21 in the Enforcement and Sanctions of Abuse of Right. Okay. While Article 19 lays down the rule of conduct for the government of human relations, it does not provide a remedy. Generally, an action for damages under Article 20 or Article 21 would be proper. I repeat, while Article 19 lays down the rule of conduct for the government of human relations, it does not provide a remedy. So, walang remedy yun. Generally, an action for damages under Article 20 or Article 21 would be proper. So, Article 21 deals with acts contra bonus mores or contrary to good morals and presupposes loss or injury, material or otherwise, which one may suffer as a result of such violation. Under Article 19 and 21, the acts must be intentional. I repeat, under the Articles 19 and 21, the acts must be intentional. Furthermore, Article 20 speaks of a general sanctions for all other provisions of which provisions of laws of which does not especially provides for their own sanctions. And Article 21, on the other hand, speaks of act which is legal but is contrary to morals, good customs, public order, or public policy and is done with intent to injure. So, I repeat, the Article 19, 20, and 21 in the Enforcement and Sanctions of Abuse of Right. Okay. While Article 19 lays down the rule of conduct for the government of human relations, it does not provide a remedy. Generally, an action for damages under either Article 20 or 21 would be proper. Article 21 deals with the acts contra bonus mores, I repeat, contra bonus mores, or contrary to good morals and presupposes loss or injury, material or otherwise, which one may suffer as a result of such violation. Under Article 19 and 21, the act must be intentional. Furthermore, Article 20 speaks of the general sanction for all other provisions of law which do not especially provide for their own sanction. Article 21, on the other hand, speaks of act which is legal but is contrary to morals, good customs, public order, or public policy and is done with intent to injure. Okay, next here is the sanction for abuse of right under Article 20 of the new Civil Code. I repeat, sanction for abuse of right under Article 20 of the new Civil Code. Generally, laws provide for their own sanctions and methods of enforcement thereof. I repeat, generally, laws provide for their own sanctions and methods of enforcement thereof. Article 20 applies only in cases where the law does not provide for its own sanctions. Hence, every person who, contrary to law, willfully or negligently causes damage to another shall indemnify the latter for the same. That is based on Article 20. Said article provides for a general sanction and indemnification for damages. I repeat, sanction for abuse of right under Article 20 of the new Civil Code, which is generally laws provide for their own sanctions and methods of enforcement thereof. Article 20 applies only in cases where the law does not provide for its own sanctions. Hence, every person who, contrary to law, willfully or negligently causes damage to another shall indemnify the latter for the same. This is based on Article 20. So, said article provides for a general sanction, indemnification for damages. In view of the general sanction provided for Article 20, a person, however, does not have an absolute right to be indemnified. It is essential that some right of his be impaired. Some right of his be impaired. Without such, he is not entitled to indemnification. I repeat, in view of the general sanction provides for Article 20, a person, however, does not have an absolute right to be indemnified. It is essential that some right of his be impaired. Without such, he is not entitled to indemnification. Alangan naman, no? Kung wala naman, kung hindi naman siya na-impaired, so wala namang indemnification na mangyayari. Okay, next here is, this is third topic from the last. Okay, sanctions for abuse of right based on Article 21 of the new Civil Code. So, sanctions for abuse of right under Article 21 of the new Civil Code. Any person who willfully causes loss or injury to another in a manner that is contrary to morals, good customs, or public policy shall compensate the latter for the damage. I repeat, sanctions for abuse of right under Article 21 of the new Civil Code. Any person who willfully causes loss or injury to another in a manner that is contrary to morals, good customs, or public policy shall compensate the latter for the damages. This is based on Article 21. It fills countless gaps in the statutes, which leave so many victims of moral wrongs helpless, even though they suffered material and moral damages. I repeat, sanctions for abuse of right under Article 21 of the new Civil Code. Any person who willfully causes loss or injury to another in a manner that is contrary to morals, good customs, or public policy shall compensate the latter for the damages. And this is based in Article 21, and it fills countless gaps in the statutes, which leave so many victims of moral wrongs helpless, even though they suffered material and moral damages. And second from the last topic is the elements of an action under Article 21. I repeat, elements of an action under Article 21 or the contra bonus mores. This was asked also in 1996, 1998, 2006, and 2009 bars. So the first one here is, there is an act which is legal. Okay, I repeat, the elements of action under Article 21. The first one here is, there is an act which is legal. So, meron siyang legal act. The second one here is, such act is contrary to morals, good customs, public order, or policy. I repeat, such act is contrary to morals, good customs, public order, or policy. Okay. The third one here is, it is done with intent to injure. Okay, yung sinasadya talaga. So, the third one here is, it is done with intent to injure. Okay, I repeat, the elements of an action under Article 21 or the contra bonus mores. Number one here is, there is an act which is legal. Number two, such act is contrary to morals, good customs, public orders, or policy. Number three, it is done with intent to injure. Okay, our last topic for today is about the civil liability for moral damages. Still, this is refers to the topic of human relations. Okay, the last topic here is about the civil liability for moral negligence. Okay. There is no civil liability for moral negligence. I repeat, civil liability for moral negligence. Okay. There is no civil liability for moral negligence. A person is required to act with prudence towards others, but not with charity. The law imposes
diligence and not altruism. Hence, the failure to make sacrifices or egoism does not constitute a source of liability. I repeat, in civil liability for moral negligence, there is no civil liability for moral negligence. A person is required to act with prudence towards others, but not with charity. The law imposes diligence and not altruism. Hence, the failure to make sacrifices or egoism does not constitute a source of liability. And that is the civil liability for moral negligence. And that is all our topic for today. I would like to read again what have we discussed. The first here is the preliminary matters, which we discuss about the effect and application of laws. The second is the second topic is about the ignorance of the law. The third is about the legal periods. 1, 2, 3, 4th is the conflict of laws. And last but not the least is about the human relations. Okay, our part 2 of this civil law review is about persons and family relations.
Thank you so much for listening. I hope my contributions have been helpful in your civil law review for the Philippine Bar Exam. I'm creating these audio recordings not only to assist others, but also to help my own study process, as I often struggle to stay focused while preparing for the bar exam. Balancing a full-time job makes it challenging to find time to study, so I decided to make this review audios. This way, even when I'm on the go or in public places, I can continue reviewing through my earphones, and it brings me great joy to share these resources with my fellow candidates. And I'm genuinely happy to be of help. See you for the Civil Law Review Part 2.